quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The medical marijuana radio, radio show.
The medical marijuana for you and me. Ah, yeah, the medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 why, yeah, the medical, it's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome once again to Medical Marijuana Radio for Saturday, the 6th of June, 2015. I'm your host, Larry Love, and we're here every Saturday to bring you the latest information on medical marijuana and adult use marijuana from all over the globe. Our guests later in the show, the second half, are Jason Hine and Dave Wisniewski from Arizona. They're going to fill us in on the legalization bills that are going on in Arizona. There's going to be two of them, and we'll learn all about that, plus what's happening with their medical program. But first, here in New Mexico, we have some news for you. As some of you know who've been listening, there was a company, a recreational company, called Nutritional High from Canada that was coming into New Mexico to purchase the management portion of Sacred Garden, one of the 23 licensed producers here. And it was pretty controversial because it's not even, we don't even know if it was really legal or not. So we've talked about that before. And the deal was supposed to close on May 31st, which was a Sunday. And nothing was heard, of course, over the weekend. And on Monday, the 1st of June, I called David Posner and asked him if the deal went through. And this is the recording of my very short conversation with David Posner on Monday, the 1st of June. The deal between Sacred Garden and Nutritional High was supposed to close on May 31st. So on June 1st, which was Monday, I called David Posner, and we had a very short conversation. Only his side of the conversation was recorded. So I'm going to just tell you the questions that I asked him. First, I asked him, was the deal closed at this time? He responded.
It hasn't closed yet. We're still working with them on it. So, yeah, it hasn't closed yet. So we're just going through everything with them.
And then I asked him if the DOH had approved the deal yet.
No, they have not. They have not made a ruling on it yet. So we haven't. We don't know on their side.
But it was supposed to close on the 31st.
Because they just had a lot of applications in for new permits, so they're like kind of swamped. So May 31st, yeah. No, it's gonna, no, we're still working through it. But if you have any other questions, yeah, feel free to give me a buzz. Okay, have a good day. Okay.
So basically right after that, a day later, the news came out that the deal was dead, and there was a big announcement in the press releases that they had put out. So I'll read you the press release in just a moment. But first, on the June 2nd, just to keep this in order, Nutritional High's stock, also known as Spliff on the over-the-counter market, someone or a group of people dumped 175,000 shares all at once, which was very odd. It went down 1.64%. And their average volume per day on the 30-day average was about 20,000 shares. So it was very interesting that 175,000 shares were dumped or traded or whatever. And just right after David Posner said the deal was still on. So, moving forward, on the 3rd of June, after those shares were dumped, there was a press release by Nutritional High, June 3rd, 2015 at 9:42 a.m. Nutritional High announces their USDC eligibility and the termination of the New Mexico acquisition and provides corporate update. I'm not going to read you the whole thing, but the New Mexico part. The company has elected not to proceed with the previously announced acquisition. See the Nutritional High press release dated April 10th of an interest in Zephyr Management Inc., a management company which was to be established to provide services to Sacred Garden, an entity licensed to produce medical cannabis in New Mexico. The company's decision was influenced by various factors identified during the due diligence process, larger opportunities in other states being pursued by Nutritional High, and a decision to maintain the company's stated focus on marijuana oils, extracts, and edibles while limiting exposure to risks inherent in marijuana growing. Nutritional High CEO David Posner commented as follows, quote, "Given the small size of the New Mexico market in relation to the cost to acquire Zephyr, to build out its grow capabilities, and to build out our edibles facility using the quality control and dosing methods that we have developed, we have decided to focus our financial resources on other pipeline opportunities." Again, that was on June 3rd. Now, moving forward, that's the day that they decided not to go forward with the New Mexico thing. Now, I don't think they decided that day. You know, my interview with David, I just played for you. It was very telling if you listen to his voice. It would be interesting to hear a voice stress analyzation of that particular conversation that I had with him. But now, today, on the 6th of June, Nutritional High stock has been halted. The IIROC can make a decision to impose temporary suspension, a halt of trading in a security of a public listed company. This was dated Toronto, June the 5th. The following issues have been halted by the IIROC. Company Nutritional High International Inc. With the symbol NHL. The reason for the halt says pending news. And the halt time was Eastern Time 15:50. I find this very interesting. Who knows what's going to happen? I'll keep you posted on this. All I have to say to Nutritional High and David Posner is this. Yes, goodbye to you, Nutritional High. We'll have to see if there were any violations. It seems very, very seedy what happened with the dumping of the stock. Now, going on to better news, okay? The House this week voted in favor of medical marijuana protections. Washington, D.C., the House of Representatives voted Wednesday to reauthorize an amendment that would protect medical marijuana operations from federal interference in states where the drug is legal, siding with the majority of Americans who say that the medical marijuana is an issue best left to the states. The amendment was offered by Representatives Dana Rohrabacher, Republican of California, Sam Farr, Democrat of California, to the fiscal year of 2016. Now, I have a couple of clips for you. This is a good thing so that the DEA and other organizations can't use their funds to mess with the medical. But unfortunately, they left out the recreational, so it's a little bit convoluted. But here is a couple of these representatives. Here's Dana Rohrabacher first speaking in front of Congress just the other day.
The chair recognizes the gentleman from California.
Mr. Speaker, I yield myself 2 minutes.
gentleman from California is recognized.
Thank you very much. Today I ask my colleagues to make a practical as well as a principled vote. My amendment would prohibit any federal funds from being used to supersede state law in those states that have legalized the use of medical marijuana. Let's be clear. The intent of this amendment is to make it illegal for federal employees to engage in efforts to enforce federal law that makes the medical use or distribution of medical marijuana illegal in states where the use of marijuana for medical purposes has been made legal. The practical aspect of this vote is based on the realization that at a time of severely limited resources, it makes sense to target terrorists, criminals, and other threats to the American people rather than use federal law enforcement resources to prevent suffering and sick people from using a weed that may or may not alleviate their suffering. There are many examples, yes, anecdotal, where the use of marijuana has helped end severe suffering. Trying to prevent this use of marijuana once it has been legalized by state government is a travesty, an inexcusable waste of our limited resources. That's the practical reason to vote for my amendment. As for the principle, we Republicans claim to base our decisions on individual freedom, states' rights as mandated by the 10th Amendment to the Constitution, and especially the doctor-patient relationship. Don't bother to use rhetoric about those principles on other issues if you vote for the federal government to supersede individual rights, states' rights, and the doctor-patient relationship when it comes to marijuana. Stop this waste of limited federal law enforcement resources. Stop the roughshod use of a federal bureaucracy from busting down doors. I yield myself another 10 seconds.
Gentleman is recognized.
Stop the roughshod use of federal bureaucracy from busting down doors to prevent sick people from using a substance that his or her doctor believes might alleviate his or her pain. Vote for the Rohrabacher Amendment.
Time has expired.
So that was Dana Rohrabacher, and also commenting and pushing this through is a great champion of legalizing and medical marijuana as well, is Representative Steve Cohen.
Reserves the gentleman from California.
Thank you. I want to thank the gentleman for yielding and for his leadership on this amendment. Of course, I rise in strong support of this bipartisan amendment. In states with medical marijuana laws, patients now face uncertainty regarding their treatment, and small business owners who have invested millions creating jobs and revenue have no assurances for the future. It's way past time for the Justice Department to stop its unwarranted persecution of medical marijuana and put its resources where they're truly needed. There's no way that members of Congress should tell the public, tell people who live in states where these laws have been passed, that what their doctor prescribes for them that could prevent pain should not be allowed.
Does the gentleman yield more time?
Mr. Cohen.
Yeah, gentleman from Tennessee is recognized.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate the time, and I appreciate all the work Mr. Rohrabacher and Mr. Farr have done, and happy to join with them. Justice Brandeis said the states are the laboratories of democracy. That's what they're doing here. Some of the arguments you've heard are reefer madness 2015. It's over. One of the gentlemen said children are doing marijuana at age 12. That'll show you how good the laws are doing right now. And if we had more money going into heroin and not marijuana, we could stop people from dying. And that's what we should be doing. Tell Montel Williams with MS marijuana doesn't work. Tell cancer patients it doesn't help them with nausea. Tell people that it doesn't work. It works. It's health. It's the states.
Time has expired.
Now, there's a good guy, Steve Cohen. I'm not sure who the woman was. I must have mislabeled that. But again, Steve Cohen right on top of it. And finally, from Colorado, another champion, Congressman Jared Polis.
Clear, the way it's being talked about by some of the other side, it does not legalize marijuana. It simply ensures that the federal government doesn't waste its limited resources prosecuting men and women who are acting in compliance with state medical marijuana laws. That's all it does. It's very reasonable that states have enforcement priorities in this area. And we want our federal resources geared towards crime that we view as more important. Have them go after the meth lab. Have them go after the heroin ring. Colorado has had legal medical marijuana for nearly a decade. Some in our state are for it, some are against it. But it's our right as a state to determine that, and that's why I support this amendment.
It's expired.
So luckily enough, there were enough votes, and the amendment was passed. And more on that as it rolls out. Now, moving on to some other interesting and good news. Autism is an affliction that is just tearing apart families that have family members with autism. But now here is a plea from Michigan to fight autism with medical marijuana. They're finding some great results. So again, this is from Michigan this week.
Parents of children with autism want to let them use medical marijuana.
A state panel held a public hearing today on this topic to let parents weigh in. News 10's Ann Perrette was there and says not everyone at the hearing was in favor of it.
Lisa Smith says medical marijuana has changed the life of her six-year-old son with autism.
I've seen my son come back to me. We've had a complete turnaround. He sleeps through the night. He eats very well. He's growing. He's happy. He's healthy.
Smith says Noah's autism has led to out-of-control behavior.
He would ram his head into the file cabinet. He would run into the walls. He would bite himself. Gag himself, pull his hair.
Wednesday, she asked the state medical marijuana review panel to make it legal for Noah to take his 3 doses a day of cannabis oil.
I'm scared to death that CPS is going to come take him away, but the alternative of having to put him in an institution would just be devastating. Physicians, parents should be able to make that choice.
But Dr. Colleen Allen with the Autism Alliance of Michigan says medical marijuana isn't the answer.
We don't have sufficient scientific evidence to demonstrate that it works for groups of children.
Individual parents testified that they'd seen improvements for their children, but Dr. Allen says there's no proof it will work for every child with autism.
A blanket recommendation to approve medical marijuana for all individuals with autism is a very slippery slope.
And Senator Jones is concerned about the safety of the drug.
We need something in law to make sure they're properly tested for things like mold and bug spray and all the other toxins.
A law he's working on this summer. Ann Perrette, News 10.
The panel has 180 days before a recommendation is due to the Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs.
There's lots of data coming out recently regarding autism and the use of cannabis. So let's hope that maybe this is a breakthrough for those people that are dealing with autism. Next up, in Minnesota, we just went from Michigan to Minnesota. Thousands are seeking marijuana prescriptions and they may not get them. This report.
Thousands of Minnesotans who qualify for medical marijuana prescriptions may not be able to get them next month.
Patients started registering for the new program today, but one of the state's largest neurology practices says its doctors won't take part for now. NORAN Neurological Clinic provides services at Abbott Northwestern Hospital and several clinics. As WCCO's Esme Murphy reports, its physicians worry they won't have enough input into what patients are prescribed.
The online registration may be open, but patients can't register themselves. Their doctor has to register them. A woman with MS told us both her neurologist who works for the NORAN clinic and her primary doctor have decided not to take part in the state program. Sarah Wellington says she is not alone.
Well, I would think that this would be a problem, especially for people who are outstate.
Some Minnesota doctors are objecting because the marijuana prescriptions will come from pharmacists at state dispensaries. Dr. Rupert Exconde at the NORAN clinic said the main problem is that we won't be able to prescribe. We won't know the components of what our patients are getting. Dr. Exconde says physicians also want to see if there are any negative reactions to the new marijuana medications being made in Minnesota. In an interview on WCCO Radio, an assistant commissioner of the Minnesota Department of Health addressed Sarah Wellington's concerns, saying,
if Sarah really wants to be registered before her clinic is ready, she should probably talk to other docs.
Sarah told us that's not what the law is supposed to do.
I don't think I should be forced to look for other doctors.
The NORAN clinic isn't ruling out eventually taking part in the program, especially if doctors get more input into the prescribing process. In a statement, the health department said it is not aware of any medical groups that have decided against participating.
Again, that is from Minnesota, new to the scene in medical cannabis. Now, moving over to pets. We've done some stories before. This is a another story. Can medical marijuana help ailing pets? There's a lot of good information that says it can, but of course there's always naysayers. Here's this report.
I've been a fan of dogs my whole life.
Bobo, Bandit, Maya, and Misty. Four of more than a dozen dogs Kiara Subas and her husband have rescued. They adopt senior dogs, like 14-year-old Leo.
You're a good boy.
But the little Pomeranian started having seizures.
I'm just violently shaking. His mouth is open. His eyes are rolling back. He's drooling.
Kiara tried changing his diet. Then she went to pot.
We were suggested by our vet in Boulder that we try a medical marijuana product for our dog.
The product is called Canna Companion. Leo started on two capsules a day.
Shortly after, his seizures definitely decreased.
On the company website, Canna Companion is listed as hemp supplements for cats and dogs. It's basically a unique blend of cannabis with low THC, the ingredient that gets you high. There are more than a dozen testimonials. Cancer-stricken Harley's happy personality came back immediately. And Kiara's Boulder veterinarian writes, the capsules have helped Titus, her 13-year-old Great Dane, be comfy and mobile.
It's not going to cure cancer. It's not going to stop seizures from happening, but it can help. 100%.
Veterinarian Dr. Sarah Brandon stops short of making medical claims. She is co-founder of the supplement company out of Washington State. In February, the FDA warned Canna Companion and similar companies to remove unproven health benefits from their marketing.
It's one more tool in our tool belt, and we firmly believe that veterinarians and pet parents should have it available to them if they choose to use it.
But the FDA warned consumers should beware purchasing and using any such products.
I personally am not a big fan of the FDA, so I would not worry so much. I don't worry about that at all.
Are you a good girl? Yeah.
Veterinarian Dr. Debbie Van Pelt isn't ready to recommend cannabis for cats or hemp for hounds.
I just think that we don't have the evidence right now to document what is safe and what is effective.
Dr. Van Pelt believes there may be potential in medical pot for pets, and she understands why owners try it.
Because people love their animals, and they are looking for ways to give them better quality of life.
Kiara Subas sees the change in Leo.
He's more alert. Overall, he seems just more comfortable.
She gladly spends $75 a month to keep her aging Pomeranian a happy pup. Kathy Walsh, CBS 4 News.
So once again, it's controversial. At one time, they said that marijuana was not good for animals and dogs, but it's coming out that it certainly helps in certain situations, especially in end life, to keep pets comfortable. Now, before we take a break and come back with our guests, this next report is from Arizona. We're going to be talking to Dave Wisniewski and Jason Hine in a few moments. But here's a report about a controversy over marijuana billboards in Arizona, where there are two competing initiatives to legalize for adults. And here is this report from, I think it was Fox News, and I think this is with our guest, Dave Wisniewski.
New tonight at 9, we've talked about it quite a bit. The push to legalize marijuana here in Arizona has already started. Supporters are working to gather enough signatures to put this issue on the ballot in 2016.
But one Valley group is upset about several billboards that are going up around town warning about the dangers of marijuana. They think it's sending a mixed message to voters. Fox 10's Jill Monnier spoke with both sides tonight. She joins us live now with more. Jill.
Well, the group that's putting up these billboards say they're not fighting the legalization of marijuana. They insist they're only focused on youth substance abuse. This is the latest billboard that popped up on a Valley Freeway in the last month. It's along the I-17 and 7th Street exit. It says regular long-term marijuana use lowers IQ. The bottom reads marijuana harmless. Think again. The billboard joins another near I-17 and Indian School that says, would your child know if this cookie has pot in it? Some believe the billboards are an effort to push voters to reject a potential ballot initiative to legalize marijuana in Arizona in 2016. But the billboards are funded by a Yavapai County group called MatForce. The executive director says they are not fighting legalization, but instead helping prevent youth substance abuse. They said they've had a focus on marijuana and youth since 2012.
We're actually a Yavapai County Substance Abuse Coalition, but with there was funding available through the Arizona Criminal Justice Commission, and we put in to do a statewide campaign. And what we're looking at is to help youth realize the risks of marijuana. We've done a lot of strategies around prescription drug abuse and have had great success with reducing that in our county. We have an underage drinking task force and work with on many strategies to reduce underage drinking. So, you know, it's just one of the many focuses that we have.
They're trying to justify maintaining prohibition because of negligent parenting. And we're saying, no, negligent parenting does not justify prohibition.
In all, Matt Force has 8 billboards between Prescott, Phoenix, Flagstaff, and Maricopa. Reporting live, Jill Monnier, Fox 10 News.
Okay, so we'll be right back with Dave Wisniewski and Jason Hine to discuss the legalization efforts in Arizona and what's going on in the medical program as well, right after these words.
I'm Robert Platchorn with Marijuana Facts from the Silver Tour. A new Florida study in the Journal of Molecular and Cellular Neuroscience found that cannabis can slow the effects of Alzheimer's and may in fact be able to halt it entirely. A University of Ohio study showed that people who use marijuana get Alzheimer's at a much lower rate than non-users. Learn more and support the truth at thesilvertour.org. That's thesilvertour.org.
Hi, as you know, over the next few years, the cannabis industry is going to explode into a multi-million dollar industry. 420webdesign.com is your affordable design provider. 420 Web Design prides themselves on fair prices and a grounded staff. They listen to their ganjapreneurs' website needs. Getting into the marijuana industry doesn't need to break your bank. Our sites come with tons of features. Just a few of them include responsive designs for mobile viewers, easy-to-update platforms, built-in SEO and SMO tools, enterprise-level security, video tutorials, database backups, Google Maps, onboard analytics, and much more. This is backed by a decade of website design and development experience. For all of your 420 web design needs, go to 420webdesign.com. Again, 420webdesign.com. Check them out.
Have you ever had a problem with overcooking your cannabis oil? You probably wanted to rip your hair out when you burned off all the THC, right? I even cried one time when my brownies failed to make a good impression at the party. Well, I stopped crying when I found Magical Butter. Magical Butter is a device with a microprocessor control program sequencer. It was designed by a scientist and a chemist to precisely extract the benefits of various herbs. Magical Butter easily makes botanical butter, oils, tinctures, lotions, sauces, and more. Magical Butter heats your oil and your herbs at the perfect temperature every time. Check us out at magicalbutter.com because it's magical. Okay, there's a lot of science and chemistry involved, but it sure works like magic.
Again, for your tinctures, butter, and oils, that's magicalbutter.com. This is a great appliance. Use coupon code LOVE to get $20 off.
This is Robert Platchorn with Marijuana Facts from the Silver Tour. According to the DEA's administrative law judge, Francis L. Young, marijuana in its natural form is one of the safest therapeutically active substances known to man. In strict medical terms, marijuana is far safer than many foods we commonly consume. Learn more and support more education at thesilvertour.org. That's thesilvertour.org.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio. Radio Show.
Hi, this is Steve D'Angelo, and you are listening to Medical Marijuana Radio.
And we're back. Welcome back to Medical Marijuana Radio. Dave Winooski, that's Wisnooski, I screwed it up, and Jason Hine, both from Arizona. Dave is involved with what's going on in Arizona with Safer Arizona and a few more organizations. What are the other organizations that you're with there, Dave?
I'm working with Arizonians for Mindful Regulation, and I was just talking with the Marijuana Policy Project, but we're not going to be working so close with them anymore.
Right. Now, there is some controversy about the MPP, Marijuana Policy Project, and the legalization efforts that they're doing and another group is doing. Can you explain that to us?
Well, there was a third group, but what had happened was the MPP came out here, and they were being financed by the dispensaries out here in Arizona. And then you have the activist groups who are just here for the people and what the people deserve the most. The dispensaries are in it for their profit and to make the big bucks. The MPP's out to legalize pot and to make the big bucks. And the people are out here to keep out of jail pretty much.
Sure. Well, let me ask you something. How does the MPP make money? Just from donations?
Probably. I don't know exactly how they make money. I'm not like a staffer, but I know that they obviously have to be making money. They make a living doing this. This is what their job is.
Right. Well, they've done a pretty good job in some other states getting medical stuff done and legalization. So what is the problem with what they're proposing as legalization and what the other group is proposing? What are the differences there?
Well, they were once the same group, and then they split off because they had an argument over the licensing portion of the initiative. And all at the same time, the people are screaming about wanting more defelonization, wanting post-conviction relief and other things that they weren't even considering. But the things that were really upset about is the MPP's legalization. They don't even call it legalization. They call it regulation because they're not legalizing anything. They're controlling it, they're regulating it, but they're keeping the same prohibition law in place. It's not really legalization, it's always recreation with not recreation, it's prohibition still there. We're putting laws on top of it, but what they're doing is they're making these thresholds so low that average people are still going to be going to jail with the MPP's initiative.
What would happen to the average person that would put them in jail? What would the violation be?
Well, for example, you're going to be buying your ounces, and they're going to be going down to what we're hearing about $100 ounces, and in the future, and you're going to be having this limit set at 2.5 ounces, where after that you're still a felon, and when you're a felony at those 2.5 ounces, and let's say you're growing more than your 6 plants, and you got your yield that's over your limit. Well, if you get caught above these limits, the law no longer applies to you. So you're going to get hit with the higher tier felonies that are still in place because the old law was never taken away. So you get past your 2.5 ounces, then you get banged with these super felonies. But just 1 gram ago, it was legal, and so it's kind of like entrapping people especially when you're going to be dropping the prices down. I'm going to want more than 2.5 ounces. I want to be able to make, and they're not even saying 2.5 ounces is legal. They're saying 1 ounce, and then it starts becoming a crime at above an ounce.
Okay, but, so the medical rule is 2.5 ounces for medical patients, right?
Right.
And that's at any one time. If you smoked up 2.5 ounces in 3 weeks, could you, or less, could you, you know, go, you can go buy more as long as you're not holding that amount? Is that the way it works?
2.5 ounces every 2 weeks. And if you buy more than that, you're going outside of your quota and you're violating the law.
Yeah, we have quotas here too in New Mexico with the medical program. So, you know, it's always been erring on the side of law enforcement over the side of the patients. That's the way it's been here in the medical. So what would the what's the name of the other organization that's trying to legalize for adults other than
Arizonans for Mindful Regulation?
One more time, please.
Arizonans for Mindful Regulation.
Okay, so what would the rule be? The law be there if their bill is the one that gets.
Instead of 6 plants, you would get 12 plants. You would also. Instead of being criminalized at 2.5 ounces, the threshold goes up to 8 ounces, which is much more reasonable for any other person. It's also got easier access towards the getting into the industry for your lower income people, so it's not completely blocked off by the monopoly of the dispensary industry.
Right now, the dispensary industry that's currently in place there is medical. So where do they stand in all of this, okay? Are they going to be the first ones to be able to sell to adults, or do you know anything about that?
Can you repeat that last part again?
Would the dispensaries that are currently in operation medically, doing the medical marijuana, would they be the first ones in line to sell to adults if either one of these legalization bills pass?
Only for the MPP's initiative are they first in line for the selling to adults.
Uh-huh. So they have skin in the game if the MPP bill wins. And right. How would they be hurt if the Mindful one wins? What would happen with them?
I'm not exactly sure about what's going to happen to the dispensaries. I'm not sure that they would be hurt. I'm just sure that they wouldn't benefit as much as if they were to keep a lockdown as in the MPP's initiative.
Do you think the Mindful group...
Jason here can answer to that question.
Go ahead, Jason. We have Jason Hine on. Hi, Jason. Welcome to Medical Marijuana Radio.
Thank you. In the Arizona for Mindful Regulation initiative, it'll give more protections to the AMMA, our existing medical marijuana initiative, or act.
Okay.
The MPP's version is written in a manner that will allow them to go in there and change it. Currently, right now, they would have to have 3/4 majority to get anything changed on it, which is very difficult to do here.
Only one of these bills will be on the ballot, or are they going to compete against each other?
They're going to compete, and we'll probably end up with both bills on the both initiatives on the ballot.
Okay, and do they have to just have a majority to win, or is there a certain percentage that needs to be had to win?
It's over 50%, and you can vote for both of them. If they both pass, I'm not sure how they're both going to be implemented or how legislature chooses. It's probably chosen by the one with the most votes, but they can both pass. And then legislature has to hash out how it's implemented.
Wow, that's really interesting. Now, so is this a done deal as far, or are they still collecting signatures? What is the process going on right now to get to next November a year?
MPP just started collecting signatures. The Arizonans for Mindful Regulation have not yet started. We intend to very shortly, probably this week.
Okay, so are you, you said we, so are both you and Jason involved with the Mindful one against the MPP?
Right, we are, and it's Safe for Arizona. We're saying support both of them, vote for both of them. That's not everyone on the team is saying vote for both of them. A lot of people are saying don't even support the MPP. I'm saying if we can't get on the ballot, the MPP is better than nothing. But ours, the Mindful ones for Arizona's for Mindful Regulation, Mindful Regulation. That's a tongue twister. That's why I just like Safer Arizona.
Yeah, I hear that. Yeah, I agree with you on that. So, so what are you guys going to do as far as have you talked to a lot of people, and is there any kind of a poll that says how people are feeling towards one or the other right now?
As far as the last poll that I've heard of was for legalization, who's supporting it, and it was 53% of Arizonians. I don't think it's an accurate poll. I think it's a lot more than 53%, to be honest, because I'm out there on the street. But as far as like how we feel about each other, are you talking about like MPP, how they feel about us and how we feel about them?
No, how do the people, you know, the consensus right now when you talk to people that want legalization, do most people that you know favor one over the other?
Yeah, everyone that I talk to that about these two initiatives will favor the one of the people because it's given us the most rights, and they don't care about dispensary monopolies on that end of the spectrum. They care about their freedoms.
Right, right. So obviously, to be able to grow is the big thing. So you said that the one that that you're behind supports 12 plants, and the other one would support 6.
Right.
That would certainly make it better for the dispensaries if the dispensaries are, you know, favoring that one over you. What do you think in your initiative that would be good for the dispensaries. Is there anything there for them? You know, besides the fact that, you know, people just, you know, not everybody can grow their own medicine, okay? You can legally, you know, if legalization for adults goes through, but it's just some people can't. They don't have the space. They don't have the money. That, you know, it's so there's always going to be a dispensary model, whether it's medical or recreational. So do you think there's, if it goes your way, do you think the dispensaries will be upset, or are they just going to roll with it and try to get licensed for adults? So what do you think, Dave?
I think they're going to make money. They probably won't make as much money as they had intended on it, but they're going to do just fine.
You know, I think that, you know, if there was less greed in this industry, you know, it seems to be greed, not green, and it should be green, and it just seems that there's a lot of greed going on. I see it in a lot of states. You know, people will be able to make a great living. This is the biggest boom to the economy and to business since the dot-com era. So, I mean, there's people that are going to get jobs, their economies in towns are going to be better, and people are going to be spending money. So legalization is going to work. You know,
I think what people need to realize is that there's so many things, so many areas that you can get in on this industry. I mean, just hemp's got, 50,000 different products. Each product's got something behind it producing it, you know, that's so much behind it. And then that's not even talking about medical-grade cannabis.
Right, so let's talk about hemp for a second. What is in these initiatives?
Hemp initiatives legalize hemp outright in about one sentence.
Okay, both of them?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's great, because I'll tell you, that's even going to be a bigger industry than, I think, you know, selling it recreational and medical is the hemp industry. Because, again, like you just said, there's just so many products and things that can be done with it. That you know, this should have been done, you know, 75 years ago. It's really quite sad that it's taken this long. So what do you think is going to happen? I guess you can't tell really, but so you guys will collect signatures. MPP will collect signatures. You know, most likely both of these will be on the ballot. So it sounds, is there any way that maybe because the two are competing against each other that they both could lose?
I don't think so. I thought at one point that was the case. I thought you could only vote for one or the other, but apparently you can vote for both of them. And with that in mind, then I think people would vote for both. I was asking around, if you saw two marijuana initiatives on the ballot, what would you do? I'd vote for both of them. And even if one got on and the other one didn't, I think it's I'd vote for the MPP if ours didn't make it on. But if both make it on, I'm going to tell people to vote for ours because it gives us more freedoms.
Absolutely. And of course, the biggest freedom, of course, is to be able to be self-sufficient and to grow your own. And let's just touch briefly on what's happening with that in your medical program. What has changed in that 25-mile rule thing? And what's going on with all that? It's been a while.
The rule's still there. Jason's got something to touch on that.
There are some rules changes that were made here recently. We have a law here that says for cultivation rights to be granted that you must reside 25 miles from a dispensary. And it was as the crow flies. And they're changing it now to actually the physical road route
right
to the location.
So has that been approved then? They are making that change?
Yes, that is going to be approved, and then, or it has been approved, and the rule change is going to take effect. Also, PTSD made it on here as a qualifying condition.
That started January.
That's what?
PTSD is a qualifying condition for medical marijuana in Arizona, which is a pretty recent addition.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I can remember some friends of mine, Heather Manis and Ken Sobel, were involved with trying to get that going for the last couple of years, and
they did a good job.
Yeah, they're incredible, and you know, everybody thanks them for that. PTSD should be the first condition that any state puts on to their medical marijuana program, just to take care of our veterans who have served and come back and overwhelmingly have said that it really helps them. So, who in the rules? And I know that, as we said earlier, the PTSD just started, I believe, at the beginning of this year. Who can diagnose that, and who can make the recommendation to get into the medical program?
So in our Arizona Medical Marijuana Act, definition of a physician means a doctor, of medicine, of that practices medicine of osteopathic or naturopathic medicine.
Okay, but to diagnose PTSD, does there have to be a specialty doctor, or can any doctor?
Oh, I gotcha. So the language on that, it is available. I just don't have it right offhand here. I am familiar with it a bit. Last time we talked, I was just going off what I knew off the top of my head, is that it has to be, they have to have shown that they have records of primary treatment first-line treatment.
Okay, yes.
And it does sound like, from what I've seen, that it's from what I've heard, is that it does come with a little more stipulations. They're still writing the, you know, once they implement something, they have to go back and adjust all these things for the certification centers, the medical directors, and the certifying physicians. So it takes them a little bit of time. They said implementation of this date will be January 1st, 2015, and it will allow for a few months of getting all that together.
Okay, yeah. Here in New Mexico, which I believe was the first state to have PTSD on as a condition, it's by the initial diagnosis has to be from a psychiatrist, but they also allow you to use a psychiatric nurse practitioner. And I'm not sure, to be honest with you, whether they have given it to psychologists at all yet, but obviously it's a psychological condition that somebody who has knowledge of needs to recommend. So I congratulate everybody that was involved in getting that on in Arizona, and I know how big of a fight it was. But of course, as you know, cannabis may not work for everybody, and when we're talking about something like PTSD, which a lot of times can make people anxious and agitated, and people say that you know, sativa is good for PTSD, but it's all about dosage. And how do you feel the dispensaries in Arizona are they educated enough to talk to people about this? Because, you know, anxiety can be taken care of with with a little bit of you know, a sativa type upper thing, but if you take too much, it can give you anxiety. So what's going on there with the education of the people running the dispensaries?
The education is doesn't matter for anything, because they don't test their buds, and so any education they give you doesn't mean anything if the buds in front of you aren't tested.
Okay, you know what, we're going through that here now. They've made mandatory testing here in New Mexico for the dispensaries, and of course, that went into effect the end of February, and of course, at that time there were no testing labs available, so everybody immediately was out of compliance, and of course the dispensaries mostly fought it, because, you know, it's cutting into their take, because it's expensive to test, and of course you want people to test not only for potency and cannabinoids, but also heavy metals and pesticides and stuff.
Yeah, they need to test more, and that's the reason why I don't feel like we have a medical program. Because who doesn't care about no home grow? Who doesn't care about not getting tested, of paying $20 per gram of untested weed? It's a recreational user. Medical patients need that home grow. They need to know that it's tested. They need it to be cheap.
So what is the in medical, I don't know, either...
A lot of here in the medical side is that... there weren't a lot of rules put in place for testing, for example.
Okay.
As far as any kind of training or, you know, the qualifications. And I'm noticing, and you see this in other states, Arizona's fairly new to us because we didn't come online until 2012. The community themselves are setting the standards. Mm-hmm. Through creating laboratories themselves, actually setting up testing, even though it's not required, and some of the dispensaries do utilize it. Also, there's training and certification programs that are popping up, educating
locally, because, you know, it is real important to have. Let's say a first time medical patient goes into a dispensary and they've never had it before. It's, you know, I was involved managing a dispensary here in New Mexico for a couple of years, and there's people that have never had it before. If they have a bad experience the first time, you know, they're not going to go back to this, what could be a great medicine to help them. So educating bud tenders and people that run the dispensaries is really important. Do you feel, after visiting some of these, that patients are getting that kind of help when they walk in?
I do believe so. I do believe that that is their intent, and they are trying to work towards that. And I, like I said, it's fairly new here to us, and with the community pushing them to hold a standard, I think that helps as well. But I think we're learning and progressing, and they're definitely, the bud tenders or the patient counselors are evolving, definitely. Mm-hmm. I think it's important that when those patients come in there, especially the new ones as you were talking about, you know, we kind of help shape the way that they see cannabis. So their first experience is really important.
So is there organizations that charge money to help you with your applications and send you to doctors? Are those popping up over there as well?
I don't know, but it sounds like a good idea.
Well, I frown on those because, you know, since I've been in the program here, I've always helped somebody that needed to get to the right doctor. But there are you know, some organizations that you know, charge maybe $60 or $100 just to point you to a doctor, and then you got to pay the doctor, and by the time you're done, it's $350 to you know, to get a license.
That's what it costs here anyways.
Some of the certification centers here will work with patients to give like a referral program kind of, and some of us that are involved in medical marijuana here in Arizona, you know, we'll work with certain certification centers to get a reduced rate for each patient that we send in.
What is the procedure for dispensaries? How do they get their medicines?
They have a network amongst themselves. They obviously cultivate for themselves, and they wholesale to each other. They can also take medicine in from patients with nothing in value returned, and also caregivers, which they are allowed to reimburse for costs. That's mainly how they acquire their medicine. Our model is really set up with multiple access points. You know, if you're outside of the 25-mile zone of a dispensary, you have the option to cultivate for yourself. So there's cultivation rights individually, with obviously that restriction in place, it makes it a little difficult.
What are the rights currently for people that can grow their own? How many plants? What are the restrictions and maximums and so forth?
It's 12 plants per patient, and they can be grown in an enclosed lock facility, something that's not in view to the public.
Does that include outdoors?
Yes. Yeah, as long as it's in an enclosed lock facility, or they do have a stipulation there that says you can have a 10-foot fence. It has to be metal, can't be visible, you know, little details, 1-inch thick gate and things like that. But the main thing I think is that it's not in view of the public.
Do you have any? Yeah, that's the important thing here as well, is that it can't be seen from any public area. You can't, here in New Mexico, you can't be, you know, 1,000 feet from schools or churches or daycare centers. There's all kinds of stuff like that.
Goes right along with the no consumption in public.
Exactly. Well, let's just recap a little bit. Let's go back to the legalization thing. How can people get in touch with you in order to help your bill?
They can go to saferarizona.com, or they could find us on Facebook. That's facebook.com/saferaz or facebook.com/saferarizona. Get a hold of me. We don't have petitions today, but we'll be having them soon. And once we get them, we will be distributing them and tracking them and getting these signatures.
Fantastic. So that was Dave Wisniewski. And Jason Hine, any closing words?
Free the tree.
Free the tree. The word free would be really, really great. I think people need to be self-sufficient, grow their own, and then they don't have to worry about anybody else. Thank you, Jason Hine and Dave Wisniewski. And keep us in touch before the election, and let's talk about it more. And anytime you need to get the word out, give us a call here at Medical Marijuana Radio.
Thank you.
Will do.
We'll be right back after these words.
Warning. The Sergeant General warns. Cigarette smoking is dangerous. Dangerous. Hazard to your head. Does that mean anything to you? Then legalize marijuana. Right here in Jamaica, yeah. Them say it cured glaucoma, yeah. I'm an Adi Bush doctor, yeah. So there'll be no more smoking and feeling tents. When I see them I come, I don't have to jump those fences. Legalize marijuana, yeah. Down here in Jamaica, yeah. Only cure for asthma, yeah. I'm an active minister.
Well, I want to thank Jason and Dave for giving us a heads up on what's happening with legalization and medical in Arizona. And I also want to thank My two radio mentors, both with the initials HS. Thank you for your inspiration. Don't forget my weekly Wednesdays with Larawana show on CannaWannaBuy.com. That's CannaWannaBuy.com. Great products for the cannabis industry, whether you're a patient, a dispensary, or a head shop. Fast shipping, great prices. CannaWannaBuy.com. If you'd like to hear some past shows, or if you miss our show, you can go to MMJRadio.com. Also, my YouTube channel, which is LSLove88. TimeForHemp.com. Also, Time for Hemp puts it on Spreaker and iHeartRadio. You can also go to CannabisTube.net. And On Now TV, channel 937. We're also heard on K-High, 1580 AM, Colorado Springs, 420radio.org, PotheadUniverse.com, and on the Roku box, the U.S. Weed Channel. If you have any suggestions for a guest or you want to be a guest, info at mmjradio.com.
Shalom.
Good night, everybody.